collaboration with our Ministry for National Security, and as well as our development partners, the European Union. And both of them centered on issues around our national security. So as civic educators, even before we rolled out our program, we did a lot of capacity building to better understand and appreciate security, violent extremism, our national security strategy, and also equip us with the requisite knowledge for us to engage the citizenry, for them also to understand and appreciate their active citizenship when it comes to security, not just as the responsibility of our security agencies, but also in collaboration and understanding and support from the citizens. So for us to collectively own our national security space and become active, vigilant citizens who contribute to that security in order to enhance our political stability, that of course sustains our democracy. So that formed the focus of last year's engagement. With the support from the European Union, we engaged the communities and stakeholders in the five northern regions of Ghana, and then the five border regions as well. That's separate from the northern region, the five northern regions. Then under the work we did with the national security, our focus was on national cohesion, in understanding that national cohesion really drives our democracy, and without that democracy, we cannot truly realize and enjoy the dividends of democracy. So that was the focus for the work in the southern side on national cohesion. I think both of these were anchored in our theme for 2021, which was We Are One, Ghana First. So realizing our diversity as a people, but appreciating that diversity can be truly beautiful, and working to appreciate our differences, tolerating our differences, and working in unison towards the realization of the blessings that we want bestowed on us. That is firmly situated in the preamble of our constitution. We want liberty, we want equality of opportunity, and of course, we want prosperity. These cannot be realized if we are not one people. It cannot be realized where there is no political stability and where there is no national security.
So would you say your objectives were met?
I think it's ongoing, and I very much doubt that all of the engagements in last year would necessarily equip us. But we have sown the right seeds, engaged the stakeholders, and the conversation continues in this year. We will soon be engaging our collaborators to see how we can deepen that conversation and enhance our national security, working closely with all our security agencies. When it comes to vaccine uptake, the work that we do was very dependent also on the availability of vaccines. And of course, as and when vaccines were available, we supported the Ministry of Health and the Ghana Health Service by adequately providing information to the citizens for to enhance vaccine uptake and diminish or reduce vaccine hesitancy. I think towards the very last weeks of 2021, we did some work on the SIN registration, which is ongoing now. We supported the National Communications Authority on SIM registration by educating and raising awareness on the exercise and encouraging Ghanaians to participate in it by providing them the relevant information to facilitate reasonably easier participation in the exercise. Yes.
And talking about the civic education process, this year, for instance, we did a story where we engaged members of the public about Constitution Day.
Yes.
For instance, and it appears to them it's a normal holiday.
Yes.
Nobody seems to appreciate what. Mm. The day, why the day was declared a holiday, mm-hmm. and what it meant to do. And then there was this call for the NCCE to maybe engage the public more on it.
No.
So that they begin to appreciate what it is.
I think for the Commission, we issued a statement. For us, the day, Constitution Day, is a day that we amplify the awareness of the Constitution, understanding that the Constitution is not the preserve of learned individuals, most likely we are talking about lawyers, but it is a document that governs your everyday living, and therefore you should be interested in it. Well, NCCE, we have a key or a flagship program on Constitution Day, which is on the 28th of April. So we have the Constitution Week, which begins on the 28th of April, which was actually the day in 1992 when Ghanaians overwhelmingly by a referendum voted in favor of the 1992 Constitution. And during that week, there's a lot of engagement with the citizenry. We share copies of the Constitution, we distribute copies of the Constitution. We do a lot of engagement with security agencies, schools, identifiable groups, youth, all of them, for them to appreciate the Constitution. Is there more that can be done? Certainly. And as we continue and strive to execute our mandate, we would, as much as we can, make the Constitution available to the citizenry. We always encourage them. Today we have various apps on social media, on the internet, that can be downloaded and people can make reference to it. So 2022, as I said earlier, all the engagement we did in 2021 will continue. But beyond that, we have a theme for this year, which is sustaining our democracy, Ghanaian values in practice. Sustaining our democracy, Ghanaian values in practice. I think the Commission took this decision at our last review, end of year review meeting in 2021, where we, having engaged the citizenry over a period of time, the recurring theme or the recurring question has been around our values. What are our values? Everybody says our values have gone down, we don't have values as a people again. And we are looking at how values tie, or that the values tie into our democracy, and how these basic universal values become the anchor of the democracy that we practice. So while we're talking about many big things and many big words on democracy, begin to ask ourselves, what is democracy? What are the values of democracy? And when we identify those values, we bring them down, break it down into recognizable or recognized values in society that are universal to all of us. They transcend ethnicity, they transcend educational class and social standing. And once we believe, we begin to truly practice these values, we would see the realization or the flourishing of our democracy. So, Mr. Sanya, today when we talk about patriotism, respect, discipline, hard work, truth and integrity, how do these values impinge on our democracy? And how do they enhance the democracy so that we can also truly benefit from the dividends that are spelled out in our constitution? So we're talking about patriotism, love for country. And patriotism or love for country is a combination of factors. It is love for your fellow Ghanaian. It is love for the resources, natural resources that have been bestowed upon us. It is love to be law-abiding. And these really are some of the ingredients of our democracy. If you love your fellow citizen, you will show respect to that individual. If you love your fellow citizen, you will tolerate the views of that individual. And these are key ingredients of democracy that allows everybody to participate in decision making by sharing his views or her views on what you consider as necessary for our development. When we're talking about being law-abiding, democracy does not exist in chaos. Democracy exists in an organized society where the individuals feel bound to the laws of the country, and where the laws of the country apply irrespective of your age, your race, your color, your religion, and that is rule of law. When we all understand that we are under the law and the law is not above any one of us, then one of the key democratic values, rule of law, is at work. So when people appreciate what the law is and feel the need to be bound by it because they believe in the country called Ghana, and these are the laws, this is what makes Ghana Ghana, they will begin to practice the democratic values that will sustain our democracy. When we talk about our national, our natural resources, it is part of what makes Ghana. So if you love Ghana, then you understand that your stewardship to the environment is key. You understand that you have a responsibility to keeping your country clean. You understand that the natural resources is what we harness for productivity, economic growth, and economic prosperity. And all of these lead to the realization and this us securing the blessing of prosperity that we say we want to see, we want for each and every Ghanaian. We talk about social justice, You talk about freedom of speech. It's about respecting each other, respecting the rights of each individual, and allowing each individual to have his or her freedom to speak, freedom to associate with whom he or she would love to associate with, all within the confines of our law. And if you do that, then we are talking of the basic value of respecting one another. So when we talk about rule of law, social justice, freedom of expression, all of these, when you break it down, this is what it comes to. So our engagements, we're going to use the usual channels that we have always used. We engage in-school youth. We engage faith-based organizations. We engage occupational associations. We engage marginalized groups. We engage security agencies. We engage all the important stakeholders that make up the society of Ghana. So for NCCE, we don't leave any one group out, unless the issue we are talking about is peculiar to a particular facet of society. We're going to use mass media, social media, community engagements, dawn and dusk broadcasts, the film shows, outdoor broadcasts, all of these we will do. But the key thing is continuing or having a conversation with people, getting their views, soliciting their views and their suggestions on how we can make Ghana a better place by living these basic universal values, which can find its space in our democratic values for us to sustain our democracy. So drawing the linkages between universal values and the sustenance of our democracy, and getting people to appreciate that our democracy is the collective and individual responsibility of all of us. So re-examining our lifestyles, recalibrating our mindsets, and understanding that what I do every day impinges on our democracy. Our democracy ensures our independence. And independence is not just political, it's also economic. Understanding how the basic values I've imbibed and I live by at my workspace promote productivity for economic growth and stability across our country. I think that mindset, civic education has a lot to do with mindset. And so there are no clear tangibles. And as it is also mindset, I doubt that within a year you can say that mindset has been recalibrated and people have changed overnight. There may be cases like that, but the reality is that it is something that we want to sustain. And so we started in 2017, where we began talking about values. We had a national dialogue on values, and the vice president was the keynote speaker at that event, in appreciating how values are tied to our democracy. What we are doing is to bring it to the fore in terms of our engagement, and in subsequent years, use that as a driving engagement with all people. So drawing the nexus between anything we choose and the values that resonate with that theme. This year, we will also be talking or driving the conversation, hopefully in collaboration with other institutions, maybe the Ministry of Parliamentary Affairs, from civil society organizations, on the big white elephant of constitutional reform. I think we've had sporadic conversations, very checkered in nature, where at some point in time, it becomes a conversation and then we talk about it and it dies down. This time we want to have a conversation with the objective of determining where we want our constitutional reform to go, how we want to carry out reform if we think we ought to reform, and when we are going to do it. So it's not going to be a conversation in abstract, it's going to be a conversation with clearly defined who, how, what, when, so that we would have a national agenda to address our constitutional reform. I think after a decade when we've seen this book, this report from the Constitution Review Commission in 2010, it's important that the millions of dollars and man hours spent on that book, we need to see the value of that expressed in how we are assessing this constitutional reform. So it is not a conversation just to say we want to implement the recommendations. When do we want to carry out that implementation? How do we want to do it? Does everything have to be by constitutional reform, or constitutional amendments, or can some of it be done by legislation? Can some of it be done by the establishment of some institution, or the additional rules provided to some other institution? How do we want to go about this? Because you see, apart from the fact that there was a lot of money spent, constitutional amendments itself is also another very expensive venture. So we must be realistic about the reforms we want and find the most effective cost-effective means of addressing it, but also ensuring that it is a process that will be owned by all the people of Ghana. It is not the preserve or the exclusion or the exclusive rights of any single group, but for every Ghanaian. That is what democracy is, participatory, and we want the full participation. NCC is particularly interested in this constitutional reform and conversation because, as you know, from that same constitution and our enabling act, our key tool of engagement is the constitution, creating awareness about the principles and objectives of the constitution, creating awareness on the need to defend the constitution against all forms of abuse, and all of these have an overarching objective, which is to sustain democracy through civic education, civic rights, and responsibilities. So for us, we are interested because it is the tool we use. And the feedback that we get, both in the media space and from our own engagements, about pockets of constitutional reform that people talk about. If people have spoken about this for many years, then we need to bring it back to the front burner of the agenda for democracy in this country. So that is what we would be talking about. And we would not be talking alone. We would be collaborating with key institutions. We also hope that the media will play their role in further broadcasting this engagement to engender a deeper conversation at all levels. We must leverage on the plethora of radio and TV stations in this country and discuss edifying content that sustains our democracy, so that the cacophony of senseless engagements that are leading to many vices in our country and more or less the indoctrination of foreign values that are alien to us and that do not promote our positive cultural values. We diminish that and raise voices that truly understand the essence of media in promoting development. So we urge media to give more space to that kind of conversation this year, so that we come up with a national agenda on what we want as a people in our constitution. The constitution has served us well, but as any society, we constantly seek to improve. So having served us well, is it dynamic? As people evolve, is it still responsive to our needs? Having served us well, have we realized any limitations? And how do we address those limitations so that we can enhance our democratic governance framework? I think the issue of apathy is not even limited to Ghana. I think it's a global phenomenon where people are feeling disengaged because there is the perception that their voices are not being heard. So like I said, that is why we want our constitution to be responsive, so that people begin to feel the essence of engagement between the citizenry and the structures of government, and how that conversation we have yields to a better world and a better society. I think bottom line, that is what people want. And the blessings that we want in Ghana that are reflected in the preamble of our constitution, I doubt that they are any different from what anybody as a global in this world wants. We want liberty. We want to understand, we want to feel and experience the equality of opportunity. And we want to enjoy prosperity, not just for ourselves, but also for posterity. And again, these are no different if they find expression in the Sustainable Development Goals, which our president co-chairs. So you see that the conversation we want to have is to improve that liberty, improve that equality of opportunity, and improve prosperity. Of course, all of these must have some pillars. We must be committed to something for us to realize these. And again, that finds expression in our constitution. Freedom, justice, probity, accountability. How are we accountable to ourselves? And how do we hold leadership accountable to us? How do we express our freedom and understand that even though I have my freedom, it ends at the liberties of another individual, respecting each other's views? And we say that we want to see these things expressed through the values we live. And in the Constitution, the values are universal adult suffrage, the rule of law, the preservation and protection of our fundamental human rights and freedoms, our unity and our stability. So you see that the conversation we had even from last year on national cohesion will find expression again this year. The conversation we had about national security will find expression again this year. At this time, we're going down into our basics and drawing our linkages between our values and our democracy, so that when we talk about Ghanaian values in practice, they actually are values that flourish and enhance our democracy. Democracy is not perfect. Mr. Sally, I'm sure we are all aware of that. And there's no one system of government for that matter that is perfect, but this is what we've chosen. And every day, we must, as the wheels of democracy grind, we must also change to suit it. Or sorry, democracy must change to suit the evolving needs of the people. And we believe that the conversation on our constitutional reform will give us a clearer picture on whether we want the reform or not. What, if we want the reform, what actually do we want in the reform? Can it be achieved without constitutional amendments? Should it be achieved with constitutional amendments? How do we undertake these amendments or reforms? What timelines do we put in place? And as an expensive venture, what becomes the most cost-effective way so that the taxpayers' money is not wasted? Let's remember, we've spent some millions of dollars already on almost 1,000-page document. It must bring value to the people of Ghana. It is part of our accountability. The initial will be a lot of consultations, a lot of stakeholder consultations across the country, and get solicit views of the people of Ghana. Our agenda would be driven by the needs and expectations of the citizens of Ghana. But because it's our tool, we find it urgent now to talk about it. Like I said, we've heard all the pockets of conversations from various individuals and groups. Now, let's have one cohesive conversation on this. Views, proposals, counter proposals, counter views, and let's take a common position on this so that the expression of our rights and freedoms and the realization of the dividends of the democracy as expressed in our constitution can truly be reflected in how we live. Always, we say where there's a will, there is a way. And we have relied not only on the government of Ghana, development partners, particularly the EU, have been very supportive. We've had support from the UNDP. We've had support from UNESCO. We have support from UNHCR. We have support from faith-based organizations like the Church of Pentecost. We have support from civil society organizations. And all of these contribute to helping us realize the tasks that we take on. And it's also gladdens my heart that this year our budget increased. And the increase in our budget assures us of our ability to carry out our tasks. So we are really grateful to the government of Ghana for their support. But what we pray for is the timely release of this budget so that we can execute our programs timelessly as well. May I again ask for the support of media in deepening our conversation through their various platforms so that the conversation will reach the ears of as many Ghanaians as we can. And not only will they hear, but encourage them to share their views when NCCE calls at their doorsteps, seeking their views on our common destiny, not for ourselves only, but also for posterity. COVID is still with us. I urge all of us to continue to adhere to the protocols. God has been so merciful to Ghana and perhaps to Africa, not in a vacuum, but also because to some extent we have also adhered to the many protocols. But as and when we are relaxing, we see a surge. And we want to ask Ghanaians to continue to be vigilant in adhering to the protocols. Again, we'll tie it to our values. Remember that when you wear your mask, you wash your hands, you're not only saving your life, you're saving the life of another citizen. And that really is the value of compassion and responsibility of each and everyone. So let's be responsible citizens. Let that active citizenship find expression in our adherence to these protocols.